Hello everyone. In today's class, we will be discussing about systemic toxicity, hypersensitivity, scarring, fibrosis, and cancer. A special note of thanks to Dr. Srivatsava Naidu for helping in preparation of the study materials for specifically this class, as I am not at all an expert in cancer biology, and his expertise is really commendable. Thanks, Dr. Professor Naidu. So let's start with the basics of immunology. So we have mostly basically immune system is the system in our body who is guarding ourselves from external pathogens, external materials, so that we remain safe. So there are two forms of it: innate immunity and adaptive immunity. Innate immunity is non-specific, so it is more of like it doesn't go for specifically this virus or this bacteria recognition or something, but instead if they find out something foreign, whatever it is, they would try to remove it from our system. So in that way we can think of that innate immunity is something like normal police. So if there is any law violation, be it traffic control, be it theft, be it a pickpocket, whatever it is, they will try to sort it out. Adaptive immunity, on the other way, is more of specific. So if there are something like the intelligence service, like say CBI, CID, so they look at the pattern. If it is some specific group's organization, it's specific group's activity, they will find it out and say this is a narcotic smuggling group or something, and they will go and catch them. So it is more of specific. So in innate immunity, basically mostly four barriers are there: anatomic or the skin, chemicals in the blood like a specific enzyme like lysozyme or so, then also reactive oxygen species, free radicals, immune cells like neutrophils and macrophages, and inflammatory response. In case of adaptive immunity virus, it incorporates the antibody specificity, where the structure is the key in this sense, a specific domain of the protein or say a sugar which actually is recognized by the cells, and therefore actually they react and try to remove the pathogen, be it a virus, be it a bacteria, whatever it is. The diversity of the system is it can recognize a wide range of antigens. So that is why vaccination is a very important term, where we actually provoke this specific kind of antigens. We expose it antigen with a little bit of deactivated form. So that specific thing enhances an immunogenicity in our body, which remains dormant for a long period. Whenever similar kind of a antigen enters in our body, the immune system triggers and then it starts fighting. So it has memory. It's once exposed, the system maintains a memory cell line for that antigen. Two major cell types are involved in adaptive immunity: B lymphocyte, T lymphocyte, and to them actually antigen presenting cells are there. So whenever there is a specific antigen or say a protein, virus, bacteria, so there are macrophages who actually engulf them, and then a part of this is exposed on their surface on some specific receptors which are called major histocompatibility complex or MHCs. So once that is presented, that activates B or T cells. So this is the cell lineage of the immune system. Originally it starts with the hematopoietic stem cell, then there is a group of cells which basically is a precursor for red blood cells. There is erythroid megakaryocytes. Then there is a myeloid progenitor which generates the granulocytes, and then another group of cells which is basically monocytes, so from which dendritic cells and macrophages are originate. And unknown precursor, there is one group of cells which forms mast cells which secretes some specific cytokines in response to allergic response. There is one group of lymphoid progenitor who basically generates three final cells: B cells, T cells, and NK or natural killer cells. So when we were talking about in different systems stem cells, we have to realize hematopoietic stem cells is also a very important group of stem cells which is present in our bone marrow, and this group of cells, basically these stem cells, generate all of the blood our blood cells. If there is any issue with any malignancy in the bone marrow, the major population which gets affected in our body, the major tissue which gets affected, are our blood. So if there is any mutation in any of these areas, then what happens is blood cancers mostly start taking place. So in the adaptive immunity system, there are two major kind of cells: B cells, which has this antigen binding receptor body. Once it is activated, it forms two different kind of cells, which is one is plasma cells or effector B cells, which basically tries to secrete specific kind of cytokines so that the pathogen or the antigen which is present in our body gets deactivated or killed. Whereas while the B cells divides, it forms memory cells. It remains in our system for a very long time, so that there is a immunity is formed, and whenever like there is a new exposure of the previous antigen, our body remembers that yes, this has been previously exposed, so let us attack this. So this is the basis of this memory cells, is one of the major bases by which our body works via vaccination. T cells forms in the bone marrow and migrate and mature in the thymus glands, therefore it is called T cells. So exhibit unique T cell antigen receptors or TCR on the cell surface. TCR can recognize antigen with associated of MHC glycoproteins. MHC, I told you before, major histocompatibility complex glycoproteins, which is basically MHC1, which is present in all the nucleated cells in the surface, and MHC2, which is only found on antigen presenting cells, that is dendritic cells and macrophages. So there are two specific population of T cells. T cells also creates effector T cells and memory T cells. There are two populations of T cells characterized by the type of glycoprotein found on the surface: TH or helper T cells, which exhibit CD4, and TC or cytotoxic T cells, which exhibit CD8. So what is antigen presentation? Answer is, if we remember our previous presentation where we discussed a little bit about the immunology, that macrophages can engulf a foreign antigen, but once it is engulfed in the inside the macrophage, there are different enzymes which degrades the specific parts of the body of the antigen. Say a peptide chain, a protein chain is cleaved into small fragments, and some part of it actually is responded from the surface. Say for example, say virus infected mouse cells. So cytotoxic T cells and TH cells, they actually goes and attaches to the surface. So TC or cytotoxic T cells basically attaches to the class 1 MHC cell, which basically is specific to any form of cells. MHC class 1 can infect, can be represented from any form of cells. Interestingly, in antigen presenting mouse cells, their class 2 MHC molecules activates the TH cells. So if the TC cell recognizes an antigen and MHC1 complex, it divides and differentiate to become cytotoxic T cells. Whereas if a TH cell recognizes antigen and MHC2 complex, it divides and stimulates beta cells or B cells, cytotoxic T cells and macrophages. So it is interesting, TC or T cell directly involves in cytotoxicity, whereas TH cell basically helps in stimulating this, and therefore TH means T helper cells. Now let us go to toxicity. A toxic material is defined as a material that releases a chemical in sufficient quality to kill cells directly or indirectly through inhibition of key metabolic pathways. So, the number of cells that are affected is an indication of the dose and potency of the chemical. So, although a variety of factors affect the toxicity of a chemical, like say compound, temperature, test system, the most important is the dose or amount of chemical delivered to the individual cell. In a common system, basically, toxicity is defined by a specific term called LD50 or lethal dose 50 in a specific bioassay when a specific concentration of chemical kills 50% of the cells, it is called LD50. Systemic toxicity is an organism-wide effect, and mortality or morbidity can be caused by failure of a variety of biological pathways and processes in response to foreign substances. There could be acute toxicity, which is basically just triggered once the material is present within the body. It could be subchronic toxicity, result in repeated exposure of the several weeks or month. And it could be chronic toxicity, which could be like just exhibited over a very long period of time. It could be carcinogenicity or probability of forming normal cells to cancerous cells. It could be developmental toxicity or genotoxicity, which is basically a toxic effect to the developing embryo or fetus. It could be genetic toxicity, results from the damage to DNA and altered genetic expression. This subchronic and chronic toxicity is an important part for biomedical biomaterials and implants, because most of the cases, this toxicity is not always predicted because of one specific reason, that in presence of tissue fluid, which enzymes and all, how a material is going to degrade, how the things are going to come out from the system, and how it is going to affect is a very confusing situation. It takes years for a material to be to pass into a body, because it's toxicity depends upon its material, its chemical composition, its surface composition, its mechanical design, and many other things, even the impurities present in the surfaces. Systemic toxicity effects of biomaterials. Systemic effects are primarily mediated by chemical and mass transport phenomena. Metallic implants release corrosion products which can reach in different parts of our body. It could present in a joint, it could be present in soft tissues, it could be present in the excretory organs like liver and kidney. Polymeric implants can release components by structural degradation. Also, if there are some specific agent which actually used for treating the polymers, say for example curing agent, vulcanizing agent or some other leachants. Also, and ceramic implants release materials primarily by dissolution. They freely circulate in body fluids, remote tissue site accumulation, hepatotoxicity or presence of liver, it could be renal toxicity, it could be lung toxicity. Different tissues in animal body always are tested whether there is any toxic inflammation or anything is present because of presence of a biomaterial. Types of systemic effects could be carcinogenic, metabolic, immunologic, and bacteriologic. Carcinogenesis, or metal ions released by implants or blood contact devices, have been shown to be either primary carcinogen, co-carcinogen, or carcinogenesis promoters. Nickel ion, cobalt ion, cobalt chromium ion, monomers of vinyl chloride, silica, carbon nanotubes, different kind of materials has been observed to enhance carcinogenesis. The criteria could be tumors must appear at a site distant from the point of application, more than one species must respond, the growth should be transplantable, malignant invasion or metastasis must be noted. Unfortunately, the metal ions and the degradation products listed above meet all of those criteria. Biomaterial carcinogenicity has been tested. Oppenheimer in 1955 carried out extensive studies on ability of implant materials to initiate tumors in rodents. The pioneering effect clearly identified potential of tumor development in rodents. Example here, Mylar or Dacron, which is used in hydrocephalus shunts, vascular grafts, nylon 66, polyethylene, PVC. They have all have been observed to have partial possibility of formation of malignant tumors. Biomaterials and tumors. So, chemical carcinogenesis caused by the substances that have leached from the implants, for example, hydrocarbon-based biomolecules, metals, etc. It could be foreign body carcinogenesis, that is, biomaterials that have caused fibrous encapsulation may cause tumorigenesis too. So, physicochemical properties of the implant disturb cellular growth around the implant, that is, from frustrated phagocytosis I have described before. Insufficient nutrient exchange and tissue damage, and viral contamination of the implants. So, three basic stages of tumorigenesis has been identified: initiation or the primary cellular form transformation occurs, then latency or no tumor formation is visible for a very long period, like say 15-20 years for human, and finally promotion of tumor, which starts happening. So, the cancer formation in human tissues mostly occur majorly by two major processes. One is chronic inflammation and another is reactive oxygen species present. So, whenever there is biomaterial implantation, protein adsorption biomaterial, cellular infiltration happens. Adhered tissue cells releases cytokines and chemokines, which recruits fibroblast cells, and over a period of time fibrous encapsulation and granuloma tissue forms. The fibrosis result in scar tissues, and those fibrous scars precedes in cancer, and thus it is called the scar cancer. There are two theories for induction of scar cancer in biomaterials. One is that cell comprising scar tissues convert them directly to tumorigenic ones. And is the other one is scar tissue secrete soluble factors that stimulate carcinogenic conversion or proliferation of tumor cells pre-existing around the scar. So, one is directly conversion of scar tissues into tumor formation, and there is also paracrine secretion of the scar tissues, which actually invite other cells which are malignant in nature, so that they can actually get recruited, and over a period of time they can get stimulated for carcinogenic conversion. When we think of the previous stuff, chronic inflammation and ROS, we should realize that ROS is something which is generated in our body for immune functions, for small molecule signaling and many other purposes. But interestingly, metal ions like say copper, zinc, iron, they actually help in development of ROS. ROS is mostly generated in response to kill pathogens or something like say virus or bacteria. But excessive exposure of ROS can create, can trigger different pathways. It can mutate DNA, it can mutate other biomolecules, it can degrade biomolecules, and thereafter it actually can develop fibrosis as well as cancer formation. So, ROS actually is generated could be because of different things like chemical therapeutics, radiation, inflammation and hypoxia. Our body naturally has machinery to save ourselves from generation of ROS. The major pathway by which ROS is generated in our body is phantoin pathway, which is activated by bi, tri or tetra metallic cations. But we have systems like superoxide dismutase, glutathione or oxidoreductase, kind of enzymes which can save our body from reactive oxygen species. It can also be saved by specific biomolecules like vitamin C or ascorbic acid, antioxidant molecules which we take in dietary form. They can also save our body from reactive oxygen species. In a nutshell, we can tell you that inflammation and host immune response, generation of genotoxic substances and growth promotion, basically here reactive oxygen species and nitrogen species can form carcinogenesis, growth and survival factors, inflammatory cytokines and angiogenesis mediators are there. Altogether, they form cancerous tissue. Porosity of the material and tumorigenesis is an important factor. The material which is more porous tend to have less possibility of tumorigenesis, whereas more dense an implant is, there is more possibility of scar tissue and fibrous capsule formation, and which further can enhance its possibility of tumorigenesis. It has been observed that filters with 0.22 micron or larger pore do not induce tumors, whereas poorly developed they develop poorly developed connective tissue capsules, but pore size below 0.22 micron are surrounded by thick collagen capsules which later on can develop into scar cancer. Breast implants were associated with increased relative risk of breast and anaplastic large cell lymphoma. Breast implants has been also found out to release specific leachants. In 1980s, it created a huge problem because silica gel was found out to be carcinogenic and inflammatory. Later on, it has been observed that the lot of breast implants which were prepared using silicon and silicon breast and silica gel actually has been called off because of breast cancer induction. It's an irony that mostly the breast implants were invented because post breast cancer removal, for the aesthetic beauty, originally breast implants were developed. Later on, it has been realized that this breast implant itself can also cause cancer. Association of implants with tumors. Chances of neoplasm occurrence in the implantation site is rare in human. The majority of malignant neoplasms induced by clinical or experimental foreign bodies in human and animals are restricted to sarcomas of various histological subtypes. Carcinomas are less frequent and when reported are restricted to situations, whereas implant has been placed in the lumen of the epithelial line organ. See here, sarcoma arising addressed to a clinical vascular graft marked by arrow and top figures of histological section. Spindle sarcoma cells are also evident in the bottom pictures. Association of implants with tumors. Usually a long latency period has been observed, 15 to 20 years. That is a major reason that carcinogenicity is often overlooked by the medical device developing organizations, because we do not know, even in an animal model, this latency period goes beyond a couple of years or 3 years or so. So it is very difficult to understand whether there is a possibility of carcinogenicity of a material or not. It appears that cancer at foreign body site is mechanically similar to those which occurs in asbestosis, lung or liver scarring, chronic bone formation. We also checked out that asbestosis, basically in the cement industry and some other chemical industry, asbestos has been observed to be present in lung tissues of the workers. Later on, it has been observed and considered it to be a work environment hazard or occupational hazard, and it also has been observed, it has been made mandatory to put masks on the workers, whoever is working in this kind of risk areas in different countries. Specifically, some other biomedical implants also known to have similar kind of carcinogenic potential. For example, there is already a report in which it has been observed that multi-walled carbon nanotubes get accumulated in lung or liver, and there is always a possibility that it might also lead to carcinogenicity. In all those diseases, tissue fibrosis is extremely prominent. The pathology of foreign buried tumorigenesis. The mechanism of foreign body tumorigenesis is not yet well understood, but experimental data suggests that it is the physical effect of the implant which plays a crucial role. Very non-reactive material like gold nanostructures, glasses, polymers shown to induce tumors, and could be due to their design. In general, solid materials with high surface area are mostly tumorigenic, and it diminishes if the implant is perforated, finely shredded, or in woven form, or have thin fibrous structures which have in between there are gaps present, like say 3D printed lattice structure or so. Pathobiology of foreign tumor body tumorigenesis also related to formation of fibrous capsule around the implant. It has been observed that tumorigenicity is directly related to the extent and maturation of fibrous capsule. Thicker the fibrous capsule is, more probability of a fibrous carcinogenesis is there. Foreign body tumorigenesis is characterized by a single transformation event and a long latent period during which the presence of the implant is required for tumor development. There is always a possibility if there is a recovery surgery and the capsule has been removed along with the implant, the possibility of a remote tumorigenesis might get avoided. Metabolic effects of toxicity. So methyl ions are crucial for normal metabolism, like say for example iron for oxygen transport, but high doses of chronic exposure can result in toxicity. Iron, for example, can induce Fenton reaction, cobalt can induce ROS generation, chromium toxicity is also observed to create hepatocellular necrosis and intravascular coagulation. It might compete with iron for anemia. Also, cobalt toxicity is observed to have neurological issues. There are specific materials like graphene is observed to have some neurological effects. Aluminium toxicity has been observed to create memory loss. High concentration of aluminium, cobalt and nickel can cause macular degeneration and retinal degeneration in experimental animals. Ionic cobalt, chromium, nickel and titanium has mutagenic action on the cells in tissue culture. It creates DNA breaks through generation of free radicals or by indirect effect. Systemic toxicity due to immune response or hypersensitivity. Unusual, excessive or uncontrolled immune response are termed as hypersensitivity or allergy. So allergy is basically an overstimulation of inflammatory response in our body, which can be harmful, can be even fatal by choking or by losing your breathing capability. Hypersensitive reaction develop during the course of either humoral response or cell mediated response. These responses are initiated by either antibody or antigen antibody complexes, which is basically immediate hypersensitivity, and there are cell mediated responses which is called delayed type hypersensitivities. So once you are exposed to a specific allergen, and just like other antigens, against other antigens in our body, specific memories has been developed, so is with other specific antigens, which immediately creates antigen antibody complexes, and it creates immediate hypersensitivity. Then also there is a possibility of cell mediated delayed response or delayed hypersensitivities. Immune response to a biomaterial or its degradation or wear products are difficult to predict, because not only depends on the nature, dose, also location of these release products and genetics of an individual. So it is a very interesting fact that allergy is kind of like personal. If not every allergy is like predict, it can be, cannot be predicted to everybody that what can trigger allergy in whom. Because you might be allergic to peanuts and another person might be allergic to some specific antibiotics. So how this to be predicted is a very important question. So there are four types of hypersensitivity which is there. One is type 1 or immunoglobulin E mediated hypersensitivity. Other is type 2, which is immunoglobulin G mediated cytotoxic hypersensitivity. Type 3 or immune complex mediated hypersensitivity and cell mediated hypersensitivity. So among them, type 4 is one of the major form of hypersensitivity, which is very important in biomaterials context. Type 4, why it is very predominant in biomaterials is because it is related to the metal allergens derived from the implant debris, and it is related to inflammatory response. If we remember back, I mentioned about metallosis in metal implant, which is basically degraded products of a metal implant or a metal debris which goes in a different local soft tissue, and it can provoke one inflammatory response, because of which there is pain, there is some other forms of problems, like say for example some cases it can lead to osteoarthritis. So T cell gets activated against this metal debris and is recruited in the implant site, and it initiate the inflammatory response and the memory is generated. So over a period of time, more the metal implants debris is deposited, more this inflammatory response increases, and in this feedback loop the problem persists until and unless the surgical invention and surgical intervention and the implant removal has been done, or otherwise people has to use small doses of corticosteroid hormones to drop down the immune responses, or sometimes immunosuppressants are also used. So implant related hypersensitivity is influenced by multiple factors like human bone marrow, the nature of patient, the nature of implant, and also the age of the person. Leukocyte migration test or LMI test has been involved in measurement of mixed population of leukocyte migration through this activity. They also call it patch test. So you can see here patch test has been conducted against against metal ions, just to check whether leukocytes are migrating, migration has been inhibited or not, and that this patch or this red spots actually is depicted to show the metal hypersensitivity. More the lead patches are present, there is more possibility that it can enhance hypersensitivity. This test in many cases has been done before surgical implantation of any material inside the body, because once implanted and it is surgically sutured, and later on if it enhances the hypersensitivity or an allergic reaction, then it will be really difficult, and by the time you remove the implant, it might cause severe injury or severe damage to the patient. Bacteriologic effect. Bacterial adhesion to the biomaterial surfaces is essential step of pathogenesis. Bacterial surface has a specific kind of polysaccharide, it actually invokes into inflammatory responses. Implant related infections can be superficial or immediate infections. It could be deep and immediate infections which occurs after surgery and caused by relocation of bacteria present in the skin or airborne, and deep and late infection which occurs months or year after the surgery in the areas with no previous signs of infection. It is either delayed display of contamination or due to presence of bacteria at other sites which is difficult to treat. Current research is directed toward designing medical devices that exhibit poor bacterial adhesion and growth. One is to include a design which is free from dead space, porous materials with small dead space. Another approach includes design of medical devices which provide antibiotic release. Choose of an antibiotic is not always possible. So instead, there are alternative antimicrobials like semetal ions, like silver or copper nanoparticles. It could be antimicrobial peptides, or it could be chemical agents like honey. It could be super hydrophobic surfaces developed by micropatterns or platelet-like structure. It could be also development of membrane disruptors, nanopillars. So there are very small nanopillars developed on implant surfaces. If there is a bacterial spore or a bacterial cell try to get settled on the implant surface, it punctures the surface, so the bacteria cannot remain over there. Also, different kind of drug delivery systems like sustained delivery system and optimized dosage, which also can help in getting rid of infection related issues. Inflammatory response is a body's response to any irritant, injury or infection. It destroys, dilutes or walls of the injurious agent, initiates the repair process, and it's fundamentally a protective response. It consists of two components, vascular reaction and cellular reaction, and it is controlled by a variety of chemical mediators derived from plasma proteins and blood vessels. However, uncontrolled inflammation is harmful. It can lead to things like hypersensitivity, arthritis, and atherosclerosis. So historically, Selkirk in 1st century AD Roman listed some specific signs of acute inflammation. So for example, rubor, which is erythema or redness, vasodilation and increased blood flow, tumor or swelling, extravascular accumulation of fluid, calor or heat, vasodilation and increased blood flow, and dolor or pain. So type of inflammations are basically, it could be acute inflammation, which is short duration. It creates edema or swelling due to change in the porosity. Wherever there is inflammation, nearby blood vessels, walls just starts to loosen up, and because of which there is an accumulation of fluid from the nearby tissues, because of which there is an edema formation, and it is mostly provided due to neutrophils. Chronic inflammation is for longer duration. Lymphocyte and macrophages take important role in it. It causes fibrosis and then later on new blood vessel formation or angiogenesis. So acute inflammation has three important components: increased blood flow, which is redness and warmth; edema results from increased hydrostatic pressure; and lowered intravascular osmotic pressure, which is protein leakage. So what happens is the permeability of the nearby blood vessel changes. So the interstitial fluid present in our body enters in the place where the inflammation is happening, because of which there is change in the osmotic pressure, the fluid goes inside. There is a vasodilation, because of which, according to our rule of fundamental rule of thermodynamics, there is generation of heat over there, and leukocyte emitted from microcirculation and accumulate at the site. Stimulus could be infections, trauma, physical or chemical agents, foreign bodies, immune reaction, even an injury. Sequence of events is, in case of inflammation, first edema happens, then there is an accumulation of neutrophils, then the monocytes or macrophages infiltrates, and finally over a period of time it is kind of like gets removed. In case of infection, further other immune cells starts infiltrating in post monocyte and macrophages engulfment, as we respond to showed you previously, they engulf the virus or bacteria. They present the antigens in their surface to the lymphocyte, that is T cells and B cells, and further then cytokines and the antibodies come into play, and they try to remove the antigen from the surface. So outcome of acute inflammation can be three. One is complete resolution of the inflammation. Second is formation of fibrous capsule or scar tissue. And third is progression to chronic inflammation. So the systemic manifestation of inflammation are fever, behavioral changes like loss of appetite, chills, and leukocytosis, that is increased leukocyte count in the blood. In leukocystosis, the neutrophilia or bacterial infection enhances neutrophils. Infection in the delayed response, we find out more lymphocytes and eosinophils in presence of asthma and hay fever, for hypersensitivity reaction because of which eosinophils and mast cells population in our body enhances. Chronic inflammation is inflammation of prolonged duration, like weeks and months, and it can activate tissue destruction and attempts at repair proceeding simultaneously. It may follow acute inflammation or begin indecisively and often asymptomatically. Persistent infection, exposure to toxic agents, or autoimmune responses, say for example somebody has osteoarthritis, somebody has systemic lupus erythematosus like SLE, which is known as, all of these diseases are basically examples of chronic inflammation. So its histological features are infiltration with mononuclear cells like macrophages, lymphocyte and plasma cells, tissue destruction induced by the inflammatory cells, for example macrophages, healing by replacement of the damaged tissue by connective tissue like fibrosis, and sometimes new blood vessels. Macrophages begin to immigrate into the tissues early in the inflammation, where they transform into larger phagocytosis cells like macrophages. Macrophages mostly predominate by 48 hours, then it recruits other cells. Activation results in secretion of biological active molecules. They also activate the T cells and B cells, because mostly T cells, because of which further new things happens, like say antibody production and all. The other cells present in the chronic inflammation are lymphocytes, eosinophils, and mast cells. So, in case of a biomaterials aspect, if we think of a acute versus a chronic inflammation, we should realize the steps works like protein adsorption, because of which there is recruitment of eosinophil, there is a recruitment of monocyte. Now, monocytes can be in the inflammatory phase can be working two ways. One, monocyte comes differentiate into M1 type of macrophages, which actually recruit other immune cells by secretion of IL-6, TNF-alpha, MIP-1, interleukin-1 beta. All of these cells basically creates more and more inflammation and recruit other immune cells. But over a period of time, what happens is this M1 or the inflammatory macrophages turns into anti-inflammatory macrophages, and they start releasing the cytokines which remove the inflammation, like IL-10, PDGF, TGF-beta, all of this. And then finally they form the foreign body giant cells and forms fibrotic capsules. Now, in many cases for biomaterial infection, then if there is issues related to hypoxic condition, diabetes and all, the major problem starts here, because from acute inflammation it goes to chronic inflammation, and the inflammatory cells do not This phase persists very long and it does not go into the scar tissue formation, vascular remodeling and other forms. So chronic inflammation is a problem in many cases where the tissue does not heal by itself after putting in biomaterial. So two strategies to control the inflammatory response incorporates surface topography, surface chemistry. I mean, more the surface hydrophobic, there is stronger the inflammatory response. More the hydrophilicity increases, the inflammatory response reduces. Anti-fouling coating formation, anti-inflammatory reagents present in the surfaces, and bioactive molecules that can modulate host immunity responses, like say cytokines, self-assembly protein, complement inhibitors, etc. Thank you for this class.